Magofies is just the most important news infographics gathering in the world. It has existed for the past 18 years, and every year here in Pamplona, in Spain, a lot of infographics people from all over the world gather and party, but at the same time, they also talk about graphics, and it's really interesting. It's an awards thing, but it is also a summit where everybody shares ideas and attend conferences and presentations. Unfortunately, infographics is something that is usually dominated by fashion. And the fashion that is going on right now, the one that is winning more awards right now, strange visualizations, I mean, strange looking graphic forms.
So the hierarchy is an important factor in graphics. Like,
people show you this fantastic spiral, including tons of data, over 20 years worth of data about traffic incidents.
And here's tweets. This is people saying good morning around the world.
And you think, wow, this is really great. This tells me something about traffic incidents over the last 20 years. But then you realize it doesn't really. It's just this incredible looking image.
Whereas in the past, I think there used to be a lot more sort of narrative illustrated graphics. Now we're definitely seeing a big move toward more just statistic rich, you know, data driven pieces.
Tenemos con nosotros a Hannah Fairfield, que es editora de infografía de gráficos del New York Times en la oficina de Washington.
I wanted to take some risks. I wanted to take some design risks. And so I started thinking about how these variables are interrelated. So you can see that the height is whether or not people are able to pay or not pay their mortgages, and the color is how many subprime mortgages are.
When you talk us through it, it's wonderful. I'm with it. I'm really understanding the whole graphic as well as you have, and you built it. I worry my editors worry about, are we taking the readers with us or are we losing them behind?
I knew that my readers were going to need a little bit of help with that. And so right up front, I said, how to read the chart.
Last year's Best of Show graphic, for example, is a strange looking visualization. It's like a stream of colors that encode the ebb and flow of movies, how several movies did in the box office. It was published by the New York Times, and it's really attractive, it's really beautiful. It's graphically just gorgeous, and started trying to read it, and I couldn't understand anything.
Lee Byron was here a couple years ago. He's joined Facebook now, but he's, you know, the movie graphic was some. That was his code.
So the technique that was in the movie box office visualization is, I think, the term that Lee came up with was a stream graph. It's a very beautiful flowing graphic, and in many ways it illustrates the kind of compromises you have to make in a visualization. First of all, it drew people in and got a whole lot of attention. It was also very good at showing sort of the overall shape of the data. But it did that by making a compromise in the sense that any individual time series in this, you know, looking at the box office receipts for one particular movie, that was harder than in a more traditional graphic.
I mean, it was very shallow. It was really difficult to extract deep meaning from that graphic. At the first level, engaging the reader with a nice looking graphic form, it works. It works perfectly. It really grabs your eye and makes you stop and try to decode it. But after that, it frustrates you.
I think we're just in a phase where we haven't quite figured out how to put these things forward to the average reader. And maybe it's just a transitional phase. I'm sure data visualization will be a powerful tool like many other tools in information graphics. It's just that right now, it's become like a cult trend. I mean, some of the people doing it are like rock stars.
You know, the illustrations that used to be so important some years ago is going a bit down in favor of some more synthetic and clear representation of data. Definitely, I think that all infographic artists, we have to evolve a lot, you know, in this statistical area.
Mm-hmm. They were saying that all Eastern European countries were voting for themselves, and all people were saying this. So I wanted to find out, is it really so? So I got the data from the European Broadcasting Union, and I put it together and started to figure out different ways to visualize it. I'm not sure what it's called, but I wanted to put them in a circle and divide them by East Europe, Western Europe, and those who didn't vote in the contest. So Eastern European countries were voting for themselves, but also the Western European countries were voting for the Eastern European countries.
I think what was recognized is that it was highly interactive, where there are variables, you know, that someone can choose from, and they can decide what they're interested in and then access the data that they're interested in. And it was executed very cleanly with simple strategic color use and, you know, clean typography, nice organization. And I think that's probably what people responded to.